I'm going to talk about transforming our now for sustainable futures. I have decided to become a professor when I was 6 years old. That was 39 years ago. My mother was a librarian of United Nations in the headquarters of our home country. So I grew up among books, hard copy books, on sustainability, environmental, social, and humanitarian issues of the time. So probably I have heard about climate change a good 20 years before any of my peers had heard of it for the first time. So at age 6, I did not know what type of professor I would become.
But I knew that it would be to do with helping the world and people. So a bit fast forward, 17 years ago, I started my PhD, which is, in my field, a ticket to become a professor. So you have to do it. And I finished it 13 years ago. And a bit more than 6 years ago, I became a tenure-track assistant professor here in Aalto. And I have 15 minutes only to tell you something about my professorship. I'm also told that I should not move my head much because my earrings might create some funny sounds. I refuse to take them off because I dressed up for the occasion. So, I'm a geographic and disciplinary adventurer. I have engineering, industrial design, and sustainability science degrees in that order. And I have lived, taught, and researched in 4 different countries across 2 hemispheres. My area of expertise is an emerging area that is situated at the intersections of design and innovation research, futures and anticipation studies, and sustainability science and transitions research. I call this emerging area Design for Sustainability Transformations. It is known by its popular name as transition design, and you may hear all sorts of variations of that. Sustainability transformation projects look something like this. Of course, they're much more complex, but the general structure has these key components. So first and foremost, in order for us to move towards sustainable futures, we need to understand the systems that we are in and what is wrong with them, what is unsustainable, what is undesirable. So we start by understanding the systems. Sometimes understanding the systems may not necessarily be part of sustainable transformation projects. However, these projects always fall back onto this discovery-based research, such as climate science. What is fundamentally part of sustainable transformation projects is visioning, creating visions of alternative futures that are radically different than where we would go if we projected our now towards the future. And then we create transition pathways. These are stories. In some cases, they might be narratives. In some other cases, they're quantitative scenarios or a mixture of both. However, transition pathways tell us or give us clues on how we can actually walk from now to these visions of alternative futures. And then starts the hard task of real-life experimentation. So these are processes that are put into place, small-scale pilot projects. They can be technology development projects, policy projects, but essentially their aim is for us to learn whether the visions are viable and whether the pathways are walkable. These being the key components of sustainable transformation projects, Dirk Lorbach, who is known as one of the fathers of transition management field, identified 3 activities as necessary for sustainability transformation projects. So these are strategic activities which deal with formation of long-term goals and visions, tactical activities which deal with implementing a change agenda, and operational activities which deal with experimentation in real life. During my postdoc in Australia between 2013 and 16, where I worked in a very large consortium project aiming to develop scenarios, visions, and pathways for transitioning to post-carbon and resilient futures in Australian cities. I wore multiple hats, including design researcher hat, sustainability scientist hat, engagement officer hat. Oh, I miss postdoc years. I also looked at what roles design has played over the 3 years of the project. So I found that design actually played roles across all these three activities and at their intersection. So each red dot is a different design role that I identified. And surprisingly, only two of those roles are traditionally attributed to design profession and design discipline. So then the implication is that there are new capacities that are needed for professional designers, which then, of course, feeds back into our curriculum development. So among all of these activities that I'm experienced in, I'm increasingly more interested in the part that deals with probing limits of our current reality and also making new realities possible, meaning creating new imaginaries of futures and challenging our assumptions about what we think to be impossible today or also possible today. And why is this important? So, a bit of a historical insight. Planned obsolescence, as some of you might know, is a phenomenon that has been one of the primary tasks of designers in 20th century. It's essentially designing in a particular lifetime into each and every single product so that the product breaks and we go to the shop and buy a new one. And this has been one of the driving forces during the restructuring of global economy and US economy after the Depression. And this was a vision put forward almost 100 years ago. Now, imagine a pre-industrial, you know, person being presented with this idea of embedding in lifetimes through design into products. I think they would think that this is very absurd. Why would anyone want to shorten, you know, lifetimes of products? However, decades after decades, industrial and political action and visions have turned us into a consumerist society. And now it's time for us to undo this. So the message from that is visions of futures are performative in the present. What we imagine now as impossible or possible has direct implications on what we do now, how we act, what we design, what we choose not to design, and all of the policies that we put outside into the world. And I'm challenging the concept of plausible future because we are actually going through polycrisis times, and all of the plausible futures that have been envisioned so far had not created momentum towards sustainable futures that are ambitious enough and also didn't create momentum fast enough to reach those alternative futures. So I suggest that we work with preposterous futures instead. We work with our assumptions on what we think to be impossible, because we might as well discover that what we think to be impossible now actually could be possible, or the other way around. So it's really important for us to work with the visions of futures, trying to understand them and trying to challenge the underlying assumptions. So just to give you an example of what it means to envision preposterously, I am teaching a course in our Creative Sustainability Masters program called Sustainability Transitions and Futures. And every year, we have a theme. So in the past 2 years, we have been working with multi-species sustainability theme. And we have been focusing on Aalto campus. And this is a course of 6 weeks through which students go through a very mini sustainable transformation project up until the point of experimentation. We don't have time to implement, of course, any experiments. However, we ideate. But I'm going to show you visions that the students came up with after doing research on weak signals. So I like this vision in particularly because of how the students turned the idea of biodiversity corridors upside down by asking the question of, well, what if we deprioritized humans and, you know, in places where wildlife needs ample space? You might be very familiar with biodiversity corridors that are very popular in conservation these days. So it creates these narrow corridors for wildlife to move from one space to the other without being obstructed by our built environment. So I really liked this turning upside down of, you know, human-centric versus more than human thinking in this vision. This is another vision from 2 years ago of another student group. So for this student group, soil and creation of soil and regeneration of soil was quite important key for achieving a sustainable future. And they wanted to challenge our aesthetic expectations from the campus. And they have essentially, their concept is based on rot and death being cherished as much as the Bauhausian modern architecture. What I really like in this vision is that they have envisioned these dry toilets scattered across the campus, installed with some bioacoustics. So when you are attending to your call of nature, you could listen soil in the making by the microorganisms. So of course, these are not blueprints. These are not necessarily going to be futures of Aalto campus. However, by way of putting these out there, and we also have shared these with many stakeholders in Aalto, including Acre, we bring these imageries into consciousness and they start to live together with other visions that, you know, that essentially direct Aalto campus towards certain development directions. So visioning is a very important responsibility of today. And I encourage us to, whenever we think about something being impossible, for example, you know, very soon I think we're going to start to hear 1.5 degrees maximum temperature rise becoming impossible. I think we should stop and challenge that assumption within ourselves as well as when we hear it in others. We really need to do this. This is a big responsibility. And I invite everyone to remember that the future enters into us in order to transform itself in us long before it happens. And this links back to my six-year-old self. I really didn't know what it meant to be a professor. I really didn't know what kind of professorships even existed. But I put a vision out there. And it entered into me, and 40 years, almost 40 years on that, from that moment on, it has become a reality. So happy envisioning and happy futuring, and thank you very much.